everybody, I'm Michael Davis. Welcome to Bone to Pick, and we are coming to you today from the Performing Arts Center here at Rutgers University in New Brunswick, New Jersey. And I am absolutely honored and thrilled to be able to spend some time today with, in my estimation, one of the greatest trombone players of all time, also one of the most influential trombone players of the last 20 to 30 years, the great Conrad Herwig. Conrad has released over 23 CDs now as a solo artist. He has garnered 3 Grammy nominations from those releases. He has recorded as a featured sideman on over 200 CDs, most notably with Miles Davis, Joe Henderson, Eddie Palmieri, Joe Lovano, Michelle Camilo, Tom Harrell, just to name a few. He is the chair of the Jazz Studies program here at the Mason Gross School of the Arts at Rutgers University. And I can honestly say, the first time I heard Conrad, which is probably now about 32, 33 years ago, it put the fear of God in me. I'd never heard the trombone played like that, both from a technical standpoint and a harmonic standpoint. He was playing things that I couldn't believe were coming out of a trombone. And I can honestly say I still feel that way now. Every time I hear him, it's just incredibly motivational and inspiring. So, Conrad, thanks so much for taking time out of your super busy schedule.
Well, great to see you, Mike.
Yeah, always great to
see
you.
Great to be here.
Let's jump right in and talk about, we were talking about it a little bit before the interview here. You're growing up, and I know you moved around, but you ended up spending quite a bit of time in Hawaii growing up and graduating from the Punahou School, which has some very famous alumni, including President Obama, as well as my own mom. So and yourself.
Great.
So, but anyway, maybe you could talk about how you got to the trombone, what those years were like in Honolulu.
Well, you know, how I started playing trombone is really simple. I was 8 years old. I was in fourth grade, and we were living in Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. My father is a retired colonel in the Army, so I'm an Army brat. And we were living in Fort Leavenworth, and I went to, they had band day, like the music man drives up in a truck. And so he, just one by one, we went through, and he said, "Hey, kid, put your arm out." And I put my arm out, and he goes, "Trombone." So then I went home with the trombone. And being that my father was in the military, he did some inquiring, and I started taking some lessons with military band trombonists. And I did, you know, played a little bit, played. We moved to Maryland, Edgewood Arsenal, and then moved to Hawaii. And so I started going to Punahou School, which had a really great band program. You know, I had 2 great band directors in my time at Punahou, and they also had a music conservatory, you know, wind ensemble, orchestra, jazz band. And so that was great. And I was sort of gravitated to taking lessons with a trombonist who had been in the Air Force, and that was Les Benedict. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the whole thing about being in school in those days, you know, a lot of schools are like this. I mean, unfortunately, with budget cuts, it changes up. But, you know, we'd have jazz band at 7 a.m., wind ensemble, take some classes, orchestra, and then 2 or 3 hours of marching band. And so you're playing your horn 5-6 hours a day. Mm-hmm. And then I was really blessed taking lessons with Les, and then Ira Nepas was also in town. So I would either take a lesson with Les or Ira. And the godfather of trombone in Hawaii was Trummy Young, because Trummy had he had married a Hawaiian girl, moved to Honolulu, and was playing at the Hanahana Room in Honolulu at the Sheraton Waikiki, which was a cool restaurant. It had a revolving restaurant, you know. And so Trummy's band was, you know, Trummy's quintet was the featured band 6 nights a week. I remember on probably my 13th birthday, my mom and dad said, "What do you want to do?" And I said, "Well, I want to go hear Trummy play." And so we went to hear Trummy. And, you know, I remember we went in the restaurant, we sat down at the table, and I told my mom, "I need to go to the restroom." So when I went to the restroom, Trummy was in the restroom, and he was there in his suspenders, and he had his dentures out on the sink, and he was trying to, you know, get his choppers in, you know? And so I was just in awe, because it was like, man, that's Trummy. So I didn't say anything, I'm just watching, and he kind of had a sixth sense, and he turned, and he looks up, and he goes, "Hey, kid, what's going on?" And I said, "Oh, it's my birthday. I'm Les's student." He goes, "Oh, yeah, kid." He goes, "I'll put a double layer of denture cream in and play, you know, high B flat for you on the next set." So, of course, I you know, ran out to the table, and I told my parents, I was like, yeah, Trummy said he's gonna play a double B flat next set, you know, and he came out and he goes, well, you know, there's a young man, he's celebrating his birthday, and this is a song we're dedicating to him, and, you know, he just was ripping, you know.
That's so great. So,
yeah, so, you know, and at that moment, I, you know, was a life-changing event that I decided the only thing I ever wanted to do was be a jazz trombone player. I mean, it just, you know, some kids want to be a fireman or a policeman. I was just, you know, Trummy was my idol. And really, you know, Les and Ira were my heroes. And there was just an incredible level of brass playing. You know, we were talking about it with the trumpet scene in Hawaii at that time. And we're talking about the early 70s with Gary Grant and Jerry Hay, Johnny Madrid, and then Ollie Mitchell moved to Hawaii and was living on his catamaran in Honolulu Harbor. And Ollie had a big band that I was able to sub in on occasions, you know, with Les and Ira and that, you know, all the guys from Seawind. So people don't really think about it, but jazz was a big deal. Like Hawaii was a hotspot for jazz in those days. And I think you've probably spoken before with Gary and Jerry, you've interviewed them. And I guess it was because, you know, two things that happened. One was the Vietnam War, so some guys were getting deferments to go to the University of Hawaii. And then the other thing was the show scene, the Don Ho show, and, you know, Elvis. I remember all those guys were like Elvis live from Hawaii in the early 70s, sure, and stuff. Yeah. So for me, I was blessed to grow up and be around those guys and study and hear Trummy so much. You know, I remember thinking, I didn't know at that time when I was 13. I thought all jazz quintets were led by trombone players because it was the only one I'd ever seen in my life. So I was figured, okay, if you want to be a jazz musician, you have to be a trombone player. And, you know, then I found out later it was the exception to the rule. Yeah. But anyway, it was a cool time growing up.
That's amazing. Great story. God, that's fantastic. Well, following that, I think you went immediately to North Texas, I believe. And I know what an amazing program that was and still is. Back then it was North Texas State University. I guess now it's North Texas University. But maybe you can talk a little bit about your time there. And, of course, the 1 o'clock band, I think a lot of people, I mean, you were known, beginning to be known already, but that kind of brought you to a lot of people's attention.
Well, that was another confluence of so many great musicians at North Texas. And it was sort of a foregone conclusion because I remember when I was a senior in high school and being... And it was, Gary Grant won't remember this, but it was probably a conversation with Les and Ira and Gary, and Gary's like, no, you gotta go to North Texas. Mm-hmm. So it was just, that was where I knew I wanted to go. And I was just fortunate to be in that climate with all those great musicians that were there. I mean, Bob Belden and Jim Powell, Jim Snidero, Tim Reese, you know, Dan Fornaro is one of my best friends growing up. I mean, they're in college. All these great players, and it was still the time of Leon Breeden as our director. And I felt, you know, it was just, it was really, you know, the school part of it was great, you know, the rigor and, you know, having the rehearsals and everything. But just having that community of musicians, and they're people that to this day are still great friends of mine, Jim Snidero especially. Mm-hmm. You know, we used to just go to the practice rooms and shed, and, you know, it was like the formative time. And it was also great because we had visiting artists come in. Dallas was really a cool place. I was able to go and sit in with Red Garland, my really good friend Charlie Young, who's the director of jazz studies at Howard University now. He'd come and pick me up in his VW, and I remember he said, we're gonna go sit in with Red Garland. And I'm like, I said, well, why don't you go sit in with Red Garland and I'll just hang out. And he's like, no, we're gonna go sit in. And I remember we went in there and Red called a tune I didn't know, and I just stood there with my horn, you know, cause the place was packed, you know. And then the guy who was a bouncer who looked like Mr. T or something came up to me and says, hey kid, can you play that horn? And I'm like, yes, sir. And so, blue, you know, Red goes like, well, kid, can you play blues? And I said, yeah, Sunny Moon for Two and B flat, you know. I was playing for my life, you know. you know, and then we finished, and, you know, the audience dug it and everything. And the bouncer came up to me and goes, "You're lucky you can play that horn, because I was going to shove it somewhere that you didn't want to know." and I was like, you know, but those were great moments, you know, and that kind of atmosphere. I remember Clark came and sat in with Red Garland, and I met Clark Terry. It was probably the first time I ever met Clark Terry. And, you know, he probably came and did a clinic at North Texas. And that was how I ended up coming to New York, was with Clark, you know, Clark, you know, starting his new big band. And I think the thing that also all of us aspired to play in big bands, I knew we're from the same generation,
sure.
that we, you know, I really had my hopes, and I've talked to John Fetchuk about this, you know, in the past. I really wanted, you know, dreamed about playing in Woody Herman's band, because Bob Belden and Jim Powell were friends of mine, and but going out with Clark Terry, you know, and then there was guys going out with Kenton's band, and all in Maynard, and there was a huge, because then that was the way also that the guys from North Texas and Berkeley and Eastman, then we all met each other in Buddy's band and everywhere else. And then the beauty of that was when you went to New York, you already had a gig. So, you know, you could go sit in or meet people, and they'd say, "Well, what are you doing?" You say, "Well, I'm on Buddy's band, but we have 3 weeks off," or something. "I'm on Clark Terry's band." And it was a great climate for jazz. I think it was, you know, and not to say it was the golden age, but it was a great time.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
For us.
Yeah, I mean, certainly North Texas at that time, I mean, as you mentioned, there's so many incredible musicians, and being around that, it's such a great point. You just come up together and you inspire each other, and then that ends up being such a great feeder system for the big bands back then. Let me just talk, or let's ask you, you know, I think you mentioned Clark Terry, and that was kind of your first big launch into your professional career. I was just going to throw out maybe three big bands that I associate with the early part of your career, but Clark, of course, and then Buddy Rich's band. And then I think we played together, but you were an integral part of Toshiko Akiyoshi's band for a long time. But but it, that seemed to all be in that kind of early period of your career. Maybe you could talk about those three bands and those experiences.
Well, I mean, look, Clark Terry, to me, is the king of jazz. I, you know, I admire him so much. He's such a giving and loving person. I consider him to be like an uncle to me. He's opened doors and helped me in, you know, getting workshop opportunities and gig opportunities. And, you know, he wrote quotes on liner notes for my albums and stuff. And it was just like, and so giving. And, you know, I really consider him to be one of the greatest human beings I've ever met in my life. Just to tell you a story, you know, Clark obviously is in Arkansas now, and, you know, we love him very much. I mean, and I'm hoping, you know, we want him around for another decade and however long. I mean, Clark's also just, you know, like an Energizer bunny, you know, keeps on ticking, take a lick and keep on ticking. That's Clark Terry. But we were, this was a few years ago, and probably his last gigs. We might have been at Birdland or the Blue Note, and everybody and their brother was coming to sit in. Like Randy Brecker came and sat in, and Randy was playing great, as we know. Randy's playing better now than he, you know, in his entire career. And so I told Randy, I said, "Man, that was great." And he goes, "Yeah, but Clark cut me in five notes or less." And so I went backstage between shows, and Clark was sitting there, and he was having his dinner, you know, and he calls me Rads. So he goes, "Rads." He goes, "All the young bloods are, you know, coming after me." And I said, "Well, Clark, you don't have anything to worry about, because they're just trying to figure out who's number two." And he's like, "Really? Yeah, yeah, you know, he's cool." And so, I mean, there's a guy who just absolutely is giving and loving. Yeah. So now Buddy, on the other hand, was a different kind of personality, as you know.
Sure.
But Buddy was also the kind of musician who gave people opportunities. He wouldn't qualify as your favorite uncle, you know, perhaps.
Well said, yeah.
You know, and we'll be nice here.
Yeah.
You know, but Buddy, I always thought when you play with Buddy, you were playing against Buddy. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I sat next to Buddy in the hot seat. You sat in the hot seat, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody really knows if you didn't, unless you played second trombone in that band, you know, having to pull out the cymbals and stuff, and constant, battles with Buddy. But if you would stand up to him and do it, it was a victory. You know, he was a great musician. I mean, definitely a great drummer. He just had his way of doing things. And one thing I would say about Buddy, that Buddy was the master of negative energy. And yet one thing is, negative energy is energy. Mm-hmm. Like when we would be on the road, and we've shared these times, you'd be on the road 60 nights, 70 nights in a row, maybe one day off. Or we'd look forward to the hit and runs because we wouldn't have to pay for our hotel. You know, you do two or three hit and runs, you're like, man, I'm saving money sleeping on the bus. But then, you know, he would use the negative energy to keep pushing the band. The only problem is then there's the law of diminishing returns where sometimes, but those, you know, people you're talking about, we're talking about, Clark and Buddy, that goes back to the great leaders. I mean, obviously Buddy is in the tradition of the Tommy Dorsey. I'm sure what Buddy did mirrored Tommy Dorsey.
Yeah.
I mean, we both played with Frank Sinatra, and I think Frank took the better parts of what he learned from Dorsey, and maybe the total, Frank could get kind of mad and angry too, but I'm not saying, I'll say Frank was a classier guy than Buddy, mm-hmm, in a way, mm-hmm, but Buddy had class, you know, a lot of class.
K-L-A-Z, class.
Yeah. No, but, you know, and I'm sure, you know, Clark learned from Count Basie and Duke Ellington and had that kind of expertise, you know, and there was that generational leadership. And then, you know, Toshiko, you know, was amazingly nurturing to me, nice to me. You know, I played in her band for 11 years. You know, I think her genius is also the fusion of her Japanese culture. You know, some of the music that I admire the most that she's written are like Sumie and those pieces where she utilizes the Japanese, you know, palette, the harmonic palette, and the Suzumi drummers from the No Play, you know, that utilizing that heritage. And Toshiko, see, that was still the lineage. And, you know, we might consider ourselves younger dinosaurs, you and I. You know, we're young dinosaurs, but it was the age of the dinosaurs in a way. And, you know, then the big bands have kind of fallen off, you know, in that way. It was so expensive to carry 15 guys on the road. But it was a great time.
Mm-hmm. I have to say one thing, just taking a slight step back about Buddy. I remember the hi-hat thing puts a fear of God in me too. Like, I remember my first night at Ronnie Scott's and I couldn't get the thing out of the drum platform. And then I finally get the hi-hat up and then I get it on top of his Italian leather boot and I scrape it across the top and he's got this big mark and I'm like, I made it through the gig, but I'm going to get fired because I can't move the hi-hat. And he's like, I walk out on the bus and he's just like, kid, what's wrong with you? And I was just like, I'm really sorry, buddy. I didn't know. I was like sweating. He's like, get out of here. That was it. But anyway, the real thing I wanted to bring up was, I think you too, like, you're so strong musically and the way you play, you bring so much intensity and energy. You know, Buddy, I know I heard him say amazing things about you and considered you one of the best trombone players that ever played on the band. But I know in testament to that, when I got on the band, all of a sudden that what was a tenor solo on Sammy Nestico's up-tempo burner Wind Machine, it was all of a sudden a trombone solo. And I remember asking Dave Panicki, I'm like, what do you mean I got to play a Wind Machine? He's like, well, Conrad played on it and Buddy liked it, so it's a trombone solo now, but Conrad's gone, by the way, so we had to keep it going. But I mean, you were that, you know, every musical stop you've made in your career, you're the right guy, but in that particular instance, you had that way to, you know, kind of...
Well, yeah, you got to put the pedal, you know, to play with Buddy Rich, was putting pedal to the metal. And it may have meant making artistic choices that you wouldn't choose. You know, you're not going to use a lot of space and, you know, artistic freedom with Buddy. It was basically you were, yeah, had to pound it. You had to hammer, you know. And but I think, for example, you know, people have talked to me, oh, how could you have played with Buddy Rich? One of the things in life is that if you've, you know, I called it jazz boot camp. It's the way I thought of it, with Buddy as the drill sergeant. Well, you know, my father's military, And one of the things about boot camp is you're more afraid of your own sergeant than you are of the enemy. So you're always going to march forward. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it was the same with us. I would say that whole class of musicians, and I remember there was great guys in the band when I was there, Rick Stepton and Lynn Viviano and, Walt Weisskopf and, mm-hmm. and Andy and Steve, Andy Fusco. And,
sure.
And the thing was, we were fearless. Like, we were kind of a rough bunch of guys. I mean, we were fearless. We weren't afraid of an audience or afraid of music, but he gave you and gave us that confidence yeah. that I think helps us in our career. I mean, it could also hurt you in some way, too, when you think of, the psychological aspects. But I think, have felt since then, and we've all been in tough musical situations, like business, music business, where having worked with Buddy gives you the confidence to say, I've been with, the king of the, of the tough guys.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think I can handle this situation.
Yeah, that's a great point. Let's jump ahead to the late 80s now, and this is when I sort of saw your jazz career really start to take hold, and you started playing with people like Dave Liebman and Richie Byrick and Jack DeJohnette. And I should mention that from my perspective, there's very few trombone players, especially at that time, that could hang with those guys musically, and you were certainly that. And even now, it's to be able to stand and play with Richie Byrick and Dave Liebman requires a very high level of musicianship in every possible way. Maybe you could talk about that time in your career, and also that's when I believe when your first record With Every Breath came out, right in that time frame, and what that was like for you, kind of launching into that upper echelon of great jazz players.
Well, I think one decision I had made, as a trombone player, we love big bands. If you don't love it, you're not going to really be a trombone player, especially in the day that we grew up. And so I aspired to play in big bands and I loved it, but I realized as far as a creative improvisational outlet, it wasn't going to be, I never looked on a big band as an outlet. In fact, being a trombone player, many times on gigs, you wouldn't even get a solo because of the nature. I call, trombone players are like the linemen of the big band, and linemen are really respected, but they don't score a lot of points, in games. It's always the quarterback and, the halfbacks and the wide receivers. So, and I accepted that there. So I always felt like for a creative outlet, I needed to do my own projects. And so it's interesting that I think it's from my Punahou years in Hawaii, I had started composing, and so I had written songs and jazz tunes and stuff, and I met Ron McClure playing with Jimmy Madison's band at the Blue Note, and started playing with Adam Nussbaum, and then Ron was like, well, we got a trio with Richie Byrick, why don't we let's do something with Richie. And I wanted to do my first album, and so I had a loft in Chelsea on 17th and between 6th and 7th Avenue, and we could rehearse there. And so we started rehearsing, and we recorded that album. And of course, the guy for me was Jim Snidero, who was my best friend. So it was Jim Snidero and Richie Byrick and Ron and Adam. And then we just started doing gigs. I looked around and we started playing in the Village. I got a National Endowment grant that helped fund a second quartet record. And then Richie and I did a duo CD. These were all, the first three projects I did. And then Randy Brecker, I met Randy and became a great friend. And then we did a quintet with Randy. And I just found some tapes with Michael and that exact band, actually some amazing, I just sent them to Randy, of Michael and I with Richie, Ron, and Adam. And that, I was blessed in my life that sort of my guy, the group that we were working with around the Village and, was this incredible group. Mm. And Richie Byrick is a great friend. Mm. And we just started hanging out all the time. And then it turned out that of course, Dave Liebman and Richie Beirek are great friends. And so then Richie would say, hey, Lee, man, you should, you know, call Conrad. And then that was when Lieb did an album. And Bob Minzer and I and Lieb and Jim McNeely and Rufus Reed and Adam Nussbaum. And we toured Europe and stuff. And Lieb told me something like, you know, you should always record with the guys you're playing gigs with. You know, Lieb always felt, and he had this idea that it wasn't always the best idea to sort of like, let's say wherever you're living, maybe in Chicago or, you know, Des Moines, Iowa. You know, if those are the guys you're working with, you should record with them because you have the best rapport. Mm-hmm. Well, the reason everyone wants to move to New York is because of the rhythm section players that we've had the great fortune to play with. So it just happened that the guys I was working with and playing in the loft were guys like, you know, Richie and Ron and Adam and then Lieb. And, you know, one thing kind of led to the other. You know, playing with Randy, I started, doing some recording. And then great tenor sax player from Europe, his name is Eero Koivistoinen, did an album. And he got, he had Ron McClure and Jack DeJohnette. And they were buddies from Charles Lloyd's, you know, days. And with those groups, because they had a trio with Keith Jarrett, Ron McClure, and Jack mm-hmm. DeJohnette, and with Charles Lloyd, that was the group. And so then I met Jack. It was pretty intimidating playing with Jack the very first time. Although I'll tell you a story about that. We did a record, and Sko was playing guitar, and Randy and Dave Kikoski, and I, and Jack and Ron McClure. And so Eero wrote this piece of his, and he said, I want you and Jack to play duo, because I want to hear how that sounds. And I had never met Jack, or we didn't, you know. And so we play, and it's just Jack, you know, throwing down, and so I'm trying to hold my own against Jack, with Jack, you know. And so we get done, and we're in the booth. And so Jack's like, yeah, kid, who have you played with? And I don't know why I said it, but I go, Buddy Rich. And Jack goes, yeah, man, you got any buddy stories, you know? And immediately, it was just funny. I'm like, yeah, I got some buddy stories, you know? And he was like, yeah, man, you know? And so we've been friends and, played on different projects. And Richie and Jack and I did a trio record later. And we played on Joe Henderson's band together. Mm-hmm. And so, but one of those things is, it is an adrenaline rush the night before you're going to record with Jack DeJohnette. You might be, I'll be staring at the ceiling. But the comfort zone, once again, is having done it sort of organically through the years. You know, you having been a sideman with Jack, you know, on different projects. And there's sort of a camaraderie, you know, like playing with Joe Henderson's band, for example, with Jack. You're just eating dinner and hanging out, and you've had those experiences, you know. And so then, you know, it wasn't such a stretch. And actually, that trio record, Richie and I had done this duo record, and we were sort of saying, like, man, what could we do that would, like, really make this? And I was like, well, maybe we could just have drums, you know. And then he goes, yeah, well, we'll just call Jack. And I said, you think he'll do it? He goes, sure. So I called Jack, and Jack was like, sure, when is it? Let's do it, you know. And it was a great feeling, you know. I mean, it's daunting, but it was cool, you know. And I've had a lot of nice times and just, you know, learned a ton of musical things from Jack DeJohnette.
Yeah, well, you've certainly you've deserved all those opportunities, and you've brought a lot to the trombone. I mean, you're the only guy that I could think of who's vaulted the instrument up into that level. And, you know, you brought up a very important name, and then probably the name I wanted to ask you about most in this interview, but Joe Henderson and your association with him, and I'd like you to maybe just touch on your memories of that. And I know that even I had heard through the grapevine that Joe was just absolutely insistent on you being the guy, and that the label was talking about other people who might be involved, and Joe just said, no, I got to have Conrad. And I thought the combination of the two of you was a match made in heaven, but maybe you could talk about that association with Joe Henderson.
Well, in the early 90s, Joe was the man, you know, triple downbeat, triple Grammy, you know. And I was really happy because I wore out copies of, you know, Inner Urge and The Real McCoy with Passion Dance, you know, and Red Clay. It seemed like, you know, Cape Verdean Blues seemed like all my favorite records. Joe Henderson was one, you know, not all my favorite records, obviously, but the amazing thing about Joe was in the era of John Coltrane and Wayne Shorter, Joe had his own unique personality that was totally, you know, not overshadowed. I mean, he just had his own musical voice. And yet, it didn't seem like he got his, you know, financially or from the music business perspective, Joe wasn't doing as well as he would have liked in the 60s and in early 70s. I mean, he was recording and he was a musician's musician. But then in the late 80s and early 90s, Joe became a superstar. And it happened that, you know, Bob Belden, a great friend of mine, was sort of a musical advisor to, they were trying to complete the Joe Henderson Big Band CD. And so I got hired to play first trombone on the Joe Henderson Big Band album. And you talk about daunting, was that Slide Hampton was the arranger on a lot of it. And, you know, having to play first trombone with Slide conducting in that situation. And, you know, it's sort of something you dream about. I think that record was with Chris McBride was playing bass and Chick Corea is playing piano and Al Foster, Nicholas Payton was on there. You know, and it was a, you know, it's a dream come true because it was like Faddis and, you know, Earl Gardner and a lot of, I mean, it was an amazing record. And so we recorded it. And won a Grammy, you know, because everything, I mean, Johan had the Midas touch in those days. So we did a week at the Blue Note, and I guess it's politically correct to tell this. You can edit it out or not. But what happened was we played, and we did the first set at the Blue Note, and the record label, because Joe was such a big star, they said, well, just Joe will play all the solos. So it was like Joe playing a solo, then the big band plays, then Joe playing a solo, then the big band plays. And it just turned out from a sort of an entertainment setting or just from a musical setting, it wasn't what they were looking for, really. Like, they needed some other people. So then they said, well, I think Renee Rosas was playing piano. They said, well, Renee can play a piano solo, and why don't we have Conrad play a trombone solo and, like, Mike Mossman play a trumpet solo. And, you know, a couple of sax, alto solo. And then I played, you know, and then I went up and I met, you know, with Joe. And I had done an album called The Latin Side of Coltrane. I gave it to Joe. And I guess Joe must have liked it or something, because then I got a call, and Edith Kagan, Joe's manager, said, Joe wants you in the band. And it's a true story that she mentioned there were some other trombone players she had tried to sell Joe on, but Joe was like, no, I want Conrad. So, I mean, that was very, you know, it's a gratifying thing.
Sure.
And then we went in the studio and we recorded Porgy and Bess, Joe's record. And that was with Joe Henderson, with Jack DeJohnette, Dave Holland, John Scofield, and Tommy Flanagan, and Stefan Harris, and myself. And then we went on the road, you know? And I was blessed that, you know, a lot of the times, the set group at that time was with Al Foster and George Mraz. And then we got Randy Brecker, and so Joe and Randy and I went out with, you know, George and Al, and started touring around. And that's a dream come true for a trombone player.
Oh,
you know,
God.
It's kind of daunting. I remember speaking, we were doing some gigs in Europe, and Sco was on, you know, John Scofield was on the gig. And I'm like, and I, you know, I'm saying, like, you know, Joe plays a solo, and you play a solo. then like Tommy Flanagan, you know, then it's like my turn. And Sco told me, well, you know, look at it this way. You know, Joe Henderson is like Joe Henderson. He can hire anybody he wants, obviously. And he goes, it's obvious he just, you know, he wants to hear you play. So just be yourself. And I, you know, Sco was being really nice. And Joe was always real nice to me. So that was a dream come true. So,
great, you know, stories. Yeah. I mean, you know, I think it's important to note too. I mean, you're very humble about it, but you, very few people could have stepped into that role, and you elevated the trombone with your talents, and that combination of that is just is fantastic. I want to get into more specifically about, you mentioned the Latin side of John Coltrane. I want to talk about that a little bit, but maybe as a lead into that, we could talk about your affiliation with Eddie Palmieri, which has gone now for the past 3 decades, I guess, or maybe longer. But I know you've worked with him in varying capacities. Maybe you could talk about your relationship with Eddie and just how your role with him musically and personally has evolved over the years.
I met Eddie through Victor Paz, and anybody who's on a brass website needs to know about Victor Paz is the greatest first trumpet player in, you know, Afro-Cuban salsa and Afro-Cuban, Afro-Caribbean jazz. He's living in Panama now, but I mean, amazing player. And I had started playing with Mario Bassa. And, you know, Mario Bassa is a great innovator and sort of godfather of Afro-Cuban music and blood brother with Dizzy Gillespie. And so I was playing with Mario's band, and Victor was playing lead. And we were actually at one of these Cuban-Chinese places over on over by the Winter Garden Theater. I think it was Asia Numero Dos. And in comes Eddie Palmieri. And so Victor introduces me, and so, you know, we're sitting there having a beer. And Victor told Eddie as he walked out, he says, well, you should call Conrad to play in your band. And I didn't know this, but Eddie later told me Victor never recommends anybody. He says it was such a shock to him. He's like, you know, Victor, and I love Victor. He's like another godfather to me. But so he had introduced me to Eddie, and then Eddie called me, and we started, I started playing in Eddie's band. I went to Europe with his salsa orchestra, with all the guys from Puerto Rico, Juancito Torres and Charlie Sepulveda, Victor Candelario in the section. But then people like Giovanni Hidalgo, you know, the greatest percussion, you know, great conga players, Anthony Carrillo on bongo. It was sort of an all-star group. I was the only guy who didn't speak Spanish at the time. I learned later how to speak Spanish just so they wouldn't talk about me, you know. But started playing with Eddie, and we just became really great friends. And then, you know, also Brian Lynch was working. I think Brian at that particular time had gone out with Horace Silver. So then when Brian came back, we were working together. We did a demo with Paul Simon, because Paul was writing his that Cape Man show.
Yeah.
And he was looking for ideas, you know, and so we recorded with Paul Simon. And then Eddie decided to start an Afro-Cuban or Afro-Caribbean jazz octet. And it was with Brian Lynch and Donald Harrison and myself. And the guy, you know, rhythm section. And so we just started working, and, you know, I mean, working a lot too. I mean, Eddie was working a lot, and, you know, Eddie has the Midas touch. You know, he's, I think, 12-time Grammy winner. Mm-hmm. And then we became so close that he's also the godfather of my oldest son. So we're, in technical terms, he's my compay. We're compays. You know, I call myself, you know, compay tercero. You know, there's compay segundo, I'm compay tercero. But we're compays, and, you know, we've had this musical relationship. I think the thing with Eddie, of all the people in Afro-Cuban and Afro-Caribbean jazz, is that he loves to take chances. He loves the trombone, because Barry Rogers, who should be a name that everyone's familiar with, we should do a tribute to Barry Rogers.
Yeah, absolutely.
Barry Rogers is one of the great, and one of the few innovators, non-Hispanic innovators in Afro-Caribbean music. the greatest trombone player probably in the history of salsa. I think the highest compliment that I get is when people come and say, "There's a, you know, you remind me of Barry," or they say like, "Yeah, you know, do you know Barry Rogers?" And you know, it's a huge compliment that they would associate, because Barry knew so much about the music. And so Eddie loved the trombone, and for those who don't know, La Perfecta was a two trombone conjunto. And so that was, you know, the band that they had, and that was where Eddie became famous. And so the trombone always had a huge role, mm-hmm. and has a huge role in salsa, you know, for various reasons. But, and so, you know, starting with Eddie was a great thing. But Eddie, you know, also Barry Rogers took Eddie to see Thelonious Monk, took Eddie to see John Coltrane's group. And, you know, Eddie's a huge fan of McCoy Tyner and Thelonious Monk. And so Eddie's one of the few people that was able to fuse that and integrate that into his music. And, you know, a lot of band leaders don't want you to take chances. Eddie prefers it. He'll get mad at you if you're not taking chances. So the beauty of that was, you know, when we got in the band, Brian and Donald and I, well, we're doing everything but the kitchen sink. If you let us, we'll do it all. And then all of a sudden, Eddie's in clave comping, you know, like McCoy, you know, fourth voicings and all kinds of like really cool reharms and stuff. And so we're able to fuse that. And that was how we started the idea for the Latin side of Coltrane. That, you know, a lot of times we would be playing a riff, like a blues, you know, like a C. Eddie has a C blues, and Blue Train just fit perfectly. We do it as a background. And then he has another piece called Azúcar, and we would just, like, as a background, we would play impressions over the top. And then, once again, a guy who's been very influential in my life is Bob Belden. Bob Belden and I were talking, and I was telling him, man, there, you know, there's... He goes, "What do you got going?" And I said, "Well, there's, you know, some ideas." And I think Bob had been at the gig, and he goes, "Man, what about, let's do Coltrane, you know?" And we're like, "Yeah, man, we could do a whole album of Coltrane, sort of like what we do when we improvise over Eddie's band." And then Brian was my partner in crime, you know, and so we just started talking about it, and we came up with a bunch of ideas. And it happened that Bob working with a label called Profile Records. And it was actually, Profile was the mother company, and I think it was Astor Place was the jazz subsidiary. Mm-hmm. Profile, because Profile had like Run DMC and all these hip-hop guys. Mm-hmm. This guy named Steve Plotnicki was a hip-hop producer, but he loved jazz, like Panama Francis and like all this stuff. So we recorded Latin Side of Coltrane. And I was, you know, we had, for those days, a pretty nice budget. I got Eddie Palmieri on there, Danilo Perez, Richie Byrack, and Ed Simon. I had four of my favorite piano players. And then, you know, Brian, Ronnie Cuber, and a lot of, you know, and then people like Milton Cardona and, you know, great percussionists, Richie Flores, Jose Clausel, along with John Benitez. So we were, you know, and these were guys who we worked with Eddie, and one thing came after another, and that's the genesis of the Latin side. Mm-hmm. And then we've been real fortunate. I've had a relationship with the Blue Note in New York City, and they have a subsidiary, which is Half Note Records. Jeff Levinson, the vice president there. And we've gone on to do, and usually what we do is we did The Latin Side of Miles, which is kind of blue, and that's with Paquito de Rivera, who's another, you know, great friend and colleague, and Dave Valentine on there. And then we had Latin Side of Wayne Shorter with Eddie, Latin Side of Herbie with Hancock with Randy Brecker, and then we just did the Latin Side of Joe Henderson with Joe Lovano, and a couple weeks ago we recorded the Latin Side of Horace Silver with Michelle Camilo. And you know, the projects, I'm a student of Afro-Cuban music. You know, when I ran off from North Texas to go out with Clark Terry. I didn't finish my degree, to my parents' horror. Later, I got a degree in Afro-Cuban culture, Afro-Cuban ethnomusicology. And so I've always been fascinated by that. But the other thing is to be able to take Joe Henderson's music and make a tribute, especially with someone like Joe Lovano, who's another great friend. Mm-hmm. It's close to home for me. With Horace Silver, I was really fortunate that 10 years ago, Horace called me to play in his band, and we did a week at the Blue Note. And nobody knew at that time that that was going to be the last week that he was ever going to perform. And the Bensusan family, who owns the Blue Note, loves Horace Silver. I mean, we all love Horace Silver. And it was, you know, sad. We're all sad about Horace passing a few months ago. So, but it means a lot to be able to, you know, perform his music and to have a tribute to honor him. Mm-hmm. And to do something fresh. You know, we're trying. I don't know if, you know, I mean, to put a different flavor. Although with Horace's music, and I think with Joe Henderson, they have such an Afro world point of view that it's easy, you know, I mean, you can quote unquote Latinize anything.
Right.
But there's some things are easier than, I mean, some things are just so natural. I mean, with Horace, like Cape Verdean blues and, you know, I mean, it's just right in the wheelhouse. Mm-hmm. And same with Joe Hen. You know, those, we did like Afrocentric and, I mean, Record of May and those tunes. You know, putting a slightly different Afro-Caribbean take on it, but
it does seem like it's a really natural fit, and I think it kind of lends itself to your playing. And you just answered my questions perfectly because I wanted to touch on all of your recent solo recordings. But I think one of the things that I admire about your playing and your career and the whole way you do it's very organic. Like it kind of like leads into what it should be musically, and we could, you know, you just kind of touched on exactly how your solo career, how you think of things, how you could see the thread musically, who's tied through it, you know, whether it be, you know, your association with Joe Henderson or Joe Lovano or, you know, Brian Lynch and, you know, all the many people that you've been associated with. And I think that's a great lesson. And for those of you who don't have those recordings of Conrad's, definitely check them out. Some amazing playing and amazing writing on your part too, arranging. Well,
they're all over YouTube, so
yeah.
Get them for free.
Yeah. You know, I want to ask
our permission.
This is one thing, and I don't mean to be controversial about this, so answer this in any way you like, but one of the things I've always disappointed is the wrong word, but I've observed, let's put it that way, in the jazz press, is that it always felt like there was kind of only room for one trombone player to really get enough attention to kind of launch up to another level. There's, of course, part of that, you touched on that earlier, like, you know, you harken back to the Trummy Young thing. It's like, yeah, most groups are not led by a trombone player. In fact, you know, we can probably name them on one hand. But one of the things that I felt, I mean, you're internationally renowned and followed by everyone, and everybody knows who you are, and there's so many fans worldwide. But I've always felt like you should have gotten more attention, to be honest with you, in the jazz press world. And you know, you've gotten a good deal, and all of it well deserved. But it's always been kind of interesting to me that the trombone never really gets a much. You know, there's always kind of room for one guy, and that one guy kind of is there for a while, and then maybe another guy. But it's unlike like the saxophones, particularly tenor players, but and trumpet as well. They have a little bit more, just a little bit more flow, I guess, in terms of the actual press and the visibility that they get. I was just curious if you had any.
I think there's a few ways to look at it. And I guess the old joke is, you know, the trombone players are the Rodney Dangerfields of jazz, right? You know, we get no respect. But the way I've looked at things, and I try to apply this to my teaching as well, is that in life there's two types of goals. There's internal goals and external goals. I've tried to focus. I mean, look, we have to focus on external goals in the sense, you know, that we're the breadwinners for our family. We have children. You know, those of us that have families, and you have to provide for your family. You have to provide a life. And so it's a business. We know it's a business. But the internal aspects of it are you know, waking up every day and trying to be a better musician than you were yesterday, trying to look for different ways of expression, trying to think outside the box. You know, I think it's Jim Snyder is the one who said that, you know, I'm not really a trombone player, I'm just a frustrated saxophone player in a trombone player's body. But, you know, I think I've had this duality that I love the trombone. I do love the trombone. I think it was probably fate and, you know, coming up and being around Trummy and Les and I were in Hawaii, and then knowing Carl Fontana and playing gigs, you know, with Carl. And, I mean, Frank Rosalino was a hero. I heard Frank live, Slide Hampton, playing in Slide's band. Those guys are my heroes, you know. And so I admire what they do. And there's a technology, I think, that was developed. I mean, JJ, one of my idols of my life, right? I mean, JJ integrated Charlie Parker's music, and I think Slide Hampton was the first one to really integrate the musical language of John Coltrane, you know, and be able to, like, if you heard and hear Slide Hampton play A Moment's Notice, I mean, you'd believe it if you didn't know that he wrote the tune. I mean, he owns that music. So, but there is that duality, and then, although I gravitated to listening to John Coltrane and Sonny Rollins and Joe Henderson, and I think I probably always wanted, maybe secretly, to play the trombone the way Joe Henderson played the saxophone, for example. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's kind of an impossible task, but it's worth thinking about. Well, the same thing, the duality for me of internal goals versus external goals. I always feel like if I take care of business in keeping my nose to the grindstone, if you continue to compose, if you continue to practice and work on new concepts, then, you know, the internal takes care of itself. And your happiness, or at least I believe, happiness comes from the wholeness of those internal goals. The external goals work for themselves. Mm-hmm. You know, in other words, I can't control what people are, and I've been blessed in my life because, you know, when you're a kid, you know, if someone told you, well, you can, every year or 18 months or so, you can do a new album, and you begin to be able to do it till you're 55, and I'm 55 now, and there's more projects, and you can tour the world playing Joe Henderson's music and John Coltrane's music and play your own music, and maybe on the side, you could do a trio record with Jack DeJohnette and Richie Bayrak. It's, so in other words, I let external goals take care of themselves. I mean, the thing that concerns me, and I'll tell you, a guy who I respect and I'm happy for, and I think is changing the scene a little bit, is Troy Andrews. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, we just were hanging out at the Saratoga Jazz Festival, and he's a super, I can call him a kid because I'm probably twice his age, super kid. And it's just, you know, I think maybe the public's perception of the trombone gets a boost, you know, from an artist like Trombone Shorty. I noticed, you know, I'm not a huge follower of downbeat polls and stuff like that, but just, you know, more people are interested in the trombone. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's all who you talk to. I mean, I know what you're saying, but once again, it's also, I think, you know, my dad always told me no one twisted my arm to play the trombone. You know, I'd done it of my own volition. And I think, for example, as I said before, we're the linemen of the team. We're the linemen of the band. So you accept your role as a trombone player. And, you know, I mean, I agree in some ways that, you know, like a trombone section. If a trombone section is great, everyone takes it for granted. If there's some flies in the ointment there, then, you know, what's wrong? Mm-hmm. You know, but we accept who we are, you know. And I mean, the one thing I know for the future, because I teach, we might touch on this, you know, is that it would not surprise me if in the next 100 years, a future John Coltrane is a trombone player. You know, because things skip generations. Like, if we go back and we went 60 years back in time, maybe 70 years, the most famous musicians on the planet were Tommy Dorsey and Glenn Miller. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So who's to say in 50 years from now that we might have somebody like another Tommy Dorsey or Glenn Miller come onto the scene, and who also is equipped with 21st century technology on the trombone that's playing Joe Henderson and Coltrane lines and stuff, and then, you know, whatever they're doing. So I'm optimistic, you know, and because look, you know, I'm so proud of you, and I'm, this is not the, like, let's blow smoke in each other's direction, but the point being, you know, you're raising the level and the awareness of brass playing for brass players, and, you know, it's up to the next generation, and we're sitting around with the next generation here, to take it, take the ball and run with it. So I feel optimistic, and although I understand completely how people feel, but it's also a responsibility of the trombone players to stay strong. You know, Richie Bayrak told me a story of his teacher, and his teacher was a guy named Maestro Palmieri, no relation. And he said that Maestro Palmieri felt that it was the job of the master teacher to discourage those who could be discouraged, because it's a really difficult life. Now, I don't agree with that, personally. That's not my personal way. But in other words, if someone, if there's young trombone players and trumpet players listening to this, you know, if there's some part of you that could be discouraged by external forces, maybe you need to think, dig deep and think about that and reflect on that. Because, you know, what we achieve internally can be worth so much more. And the history is full also of artists who were not acknowledged in their time. You know, Van Gogh comes, that's the classic cliche, right? Van Gogh never sold a painting. Now, you know, I mean, you gotta be a billionaire to buy a Van Gogh. And so, well, was his art, he might not even care. It, I mean, who knows, Van Gogh might even be pissed off that his, you know, he'd say, well, you should value my art for what it is, not for how much it's worth. Because now it's a trophy, right? And so we, it depends on how we look at art, but I appreciate the sentiment, and we just have to stay tough.
That's great advice, Conrad, and thank you. I think the way you describe the internal and external goals is a really, it's helpful to me just hearing it, and I can imagine for all of us trying to improve ourselves on a daily basis, it's a great, really great way to look at it. I'd kind of like to shift gears right now and talk, we're here at Rutgers University, a great program that you've helped develop substantially over the last decade or so. Of course, your role as a teacher of jazz trombone, improvisation, composition, and arranging, but now you're also the chair of the Jazz Studies program, which I know brings on a whole nother level of responsibility and what you bring to your students. So maybe you could talk about that. And I also I wanted to touch on your association with the Mingus Band. It's an important one, but this is kind of a nice parlay into that, because I know that Sue Mingus has donated some funds to the school, and you guys have an association. So it's kind of a wide question, but maybe you could just talk a little bit about what it's like being here at Rutgers and your program and where you're headed with things and all of that.
Sure. You know, one of the beauties of Rutgers is that we're situated right between New York City and Philadelphia, pretty much right in the middle. It's about, well, it's maybe 45 minutes to the city and an hour to Philadelphia from where we are, which puts us in the center of, you know, the jazz, you know, mecca, kind of. It's and it's the school, Rutgers University Mason Grove School of the Arts, has a storied history of jazz studies, you know, with professors like Larry Ridley started the jazz program, or was one of the founders, and Kenny Barron was here. Professor William Fielder, who's one of the great brass gurus of all time, you know, Prof. Fielder. In fact, I have Prof. Fielder's office. It's sort of like, you know, an incredible mantle, you know, to be. And Prof. was the director of jazz studies, the chair of jazz studies also. So it's a, there's a storied history with all kinds of alums too, you know. People like Terrence Blanchard and Terrell Stafford and Frank Lacey and Ralph Bowen and Kenny Davis, some of the our professors here. But and if you research it, there's a lot of Rutgers grads, Mike Mossman, a lot of great brass players.
Wow, that's interesting. I didn't know there so many great players.
Prof Fielder was one of the great gurus and probably one of the, you know, we talk about someone not getting fame. I mean, he was famous. I think, you know, people like Wynton Marsalis will tell you. I mean, when Prof Fielder passed 6 years ago, every year we have a memorial concert, and it was like a who's who of brass playing. You know, Wynton came and Sean Jones and Terrell Stafford and John Faddis and Frank Lacey. So there is quite a history. We have a really interesting program. I think 60 jazz majors. We're tied into the New York City scene. We have the Mingus Project now, which Sue Mingus has funded. And it's a program where we bring 10 members every year in one at a time. They come for a master class 10 times a year, 5 times each semester. And we have a Mingus Ensemble now that performs. And it's very close to my heart because I've been playing with the Mingus Big Band for over 20 years now. And it's really exciting. You know, we've had we've had people like Seamus Blake and Alex Sipiagin, Frank Lacey, Earl McIntyre, Philip Harper for the brass players. So it's intense, a lot of fun. We talk about all aspects of Mingus's music, from the harmonic compositional aspects to how to improvise on his tunes to the sort of socio-political views and the climate of his day and age that fits our day and age, because there's really no difference between what was going on in the South in Arkansas in the 50s and what's going on in Ferguson, Missouri today. It's amazingly sadly the same. I mean, it's eerie, you know, but Mingus was sort of a Nostradamus of jazz in that way, and like really political message. And so we've been doing that, and you know, so the Mingus Project is huge. We also have Eddie Palmieri as a visiting professor, and Fred Hirsch, which is great. So Eddie comes once a month and teaches composition and arranging and a master class, and we have an Afro-Caribbean ensemble that Bill O'Connell leads. And, you know, there's all kinds of interaction. You know, kids are learning the ins and outs of Afro-Cuban music and Afro-Caribbean music. I've told our students, being in class with Eddie Palmieri learning Afro-Caribbean music would be like having Charlie Parker in the class learning bebop. Mm-hmm. It's the same. I mean, you can't go any closer to the source.
Right.
And it's really gratifying to watch Eddie teaching the piano players. I mean, where better are you going to learn how to play Montunos than from Eddie Palmieri?
Absolutely.
And so we have the ability. Eddie is going to be one of our guest soloists this year. We also had, you know, Tane came in as a clinician last year, and Tane's coming back as a guest artist. I'm very fortunate that I'm in the Watts Family Reunion Band, So Tane and his wife Laura are very gracious, and so there's a lot going on. You know, we try to run the gamut of, you know, jazz history. Our graduate students study with Dr. Lewis Porter up in Newark, and we have the access to the world's greatest jazz archives, which is the Jazz Institute in Newark, the Rutgers Jazz Institute. And we compose, we arrange, we work on improv. And then we have relationships with the Blue Note students. We perform at the Blue Note with students and the faculty. And it, you know, it's a dream come true for me. You know, our faculty ensemble includes, you know, Victor Lewis on drums, Kenny Davis, Bill O'Connell, Vic Juris, Robbie Amin has joined the faculty. So percussion students who want to study Afro-Cuban music and that Afro-Caribbean. We've had Stefan Harris here teaching mallets to the drummers. So it's exciting.
Yeah. You know,
it's real exciting. I'd agree with you. Being a chair brings a different skill set. You know, it's different than, you know, being a trombone player. But I've enjoyed it, and I've felt the responsibility, and you know, the my role models and mentors who came before me, you know, like Larry Ridley and Prof Fielder and Kenny Barron, you know, it's John Stubblefield taught here, you know, Mike Mossman was here. It's like, I think Rutgers is sort of a not a diamond in the rough, but I think we've been under the radar, and so being a state university and having the access, we're also in the Big Ten. So interestingly, the Big Ten, we share music libraries with every Big Ten school. So Indiana, Michigan, we all have and there's a term, it's a consortium of the Big Ten schools. So it really is a great resource educationally. And we're just kind of at the tip of the iceberg because this is our first year in the Big Ten, but it's real exciting.
Yeah, that's great stuff. Well, I think you're no longer under the radar. I think you've built a great program here, and I can't recommend it highly enough. I was doing master class. I can't remember what it was, and he's one of your students now, but a young man, a trombone player, came up to me, and he said, yeah, you sound really good. Where are you going to school? He goes, oh, I'm going to Rutgers. I said, you going to study with Connor? He says, yeah, I hope so. And I said, you cannot be in better hands. So, and I happened to run into him a year later, and I said, it's going great for you, right? He's like, it's the best. It's the best.
Well, that's nice of you to say.
You're doing great stuff here, and continued success with it. Conrad, as we wind down, and you've given us so much information today, that's just been great. I mean, I got a lot out of it, just on how to approach life and music and all those things. But I like to kind of always end up our interviews with just asking a great artist like yourself, if there are young musicians out there, and I know you're influencing them on a daily basis personally, but if you could just kind of give a message, you know, a couple of things that come to your mind as what you would advise to young people thinking about going into music who have a passion for it, who think of maybe, oh, I could be the next Conrad Herwig, what might that be?
Well, you know, I've been asked that question a few times before. And this may seem a little counterintuitive because I think in music, you know, we start as young players and we spend a lot of time on our own practicing, and it becomes, and I don't know of another way to say it, but sort of a me world. It's about ourselves. Rightly so, because, you know, there's not a lot of instant gratification in playing a brass instrument. It takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of practice, it takes a lot of consistent commitment, right? But the advice I would give to any young musician is, you know, learn how to make other people sound good. I think a lot of young players, one of the things, and we've seen them come and go, you know, for 30 years, is that it, you know, it's about how I sound, my solo, right? But you've been very successful in your life learning how to make other people sound great. Like, you've learned how to make the Rolling Stones sound great, how to make, Frank Sinatra sound great. In other words, that's the job of a musician, right, is basically making other people sound good. And then in the moment, then when you have your platform, then you take your solo, and if you can do that too, you know, then you're successful. In other words, a young rhythm section player, I think it's more obvious for rhythm section players know that they're an accompaniment role there, a drummer or a bass player, whoever they're accompanying. But even for brass players, you know, if you're thinking in a sense, like, I'll give you an example as a jazz musician, if you can make a rhythm section sound great, that skill will continually, you know, people won't really understand, well, why is it that person was hired? Like, why does she always get the gig? Well, because whenever she's playing, those around her are at a higher level. And, you know, probably some role models in life, like a Michael Jordan. You know, when Michael Jordan was on the team, some of those guys around him were all-stars. Then they go to other teams, they never made the all-star team again, you know? Mm-hmm. So, and we know that with like a great conductor, like a Lauren Mizell or who, you know, that then all of a sudden, whatever group they're conducting, the level is raised. So I think, you know, that would be my biggest advice. And, you know, I've had the blessing of performing in a lot of people's bands, you know, and I know that my highest goal always, you know, if you ask me, is like, you know, I want to make Clark Terry sound great. I want to make Eddie Palmieri sound great. I want to make Joe Henderson sound great. That was my deepest desire. You know, it may appear differently if you're looking back at a video or, you know, but honestly, you know, that I think that's kind of goes hand in hand with that internal goal. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a story, I go around and do quartet gigs, you know, with rhythm sections. And I was actually in the Pacific Northwest doing a gig with a quartet. And it was in a club that's been there. I think it's not there anymore, but it was there for years and years. And, you know, it was the same crowd of people would come every night. They had beer mugs with their names etched on it. And they had, like, bar stools with their name on it. They were sitting on their own name there. And a couple of old-timers came, and they told me, you know, we had finished a set, you know, a couple, like, you know, three set night, and they said, I've been coming out here for 30 years, and that's the best I ever heard that rhythm section sound in 30 years. Now, you know, it wasn't like they didn't come up to me and say, wow, that was a great trombone set. They said, that's the best I ever heard that rhythm. And, you know, that was one of the best compliments I ever received, because wow. It made me feel like, yeah, you know, that's, so that quality that I'm talking about, it can be learned, but you have to have sort of a sixth sense when you're playing. Because I think what happens is, you know, we're out there and we're in the moment and there's all this adrenaline flow. And so we play our solo and then, you know, it has what it has. But think about Miles Davis. Miles, every one of the musicians that were around him became superstars. Mm-hmm. He made every one of them. And probably taught them how great they could be. Mm-hmm. I mean, not that Herbie and Chick and Keith Jarrett and, you know, Jack and Tony Williams and Ron Carter and Dave Holland weren't going to be among the greatest players, but they all learned how good they could sound and how great they could make other people sound. And that skill, to me, is sort of an intangible that doesn't get talked about a lot. Mm.
Wow, that is some great advice. And I think using the sports analogy is great too. I mean, you think about the great players on any sport, but you know, people talk about Magic Johnson or Larry Bird and they revere them, and that's the first thing everybody says is makes everybody else around them better. So a great, thank you for that, Conrad. A great, great way to approach playing music. So, well, listen, Conrad, thank you so much for taking so much of your time today and the great advice and sharing all the amazing stories in your life and your career. And continued success with everything, and most of all, from a trombone perspective, thanks for all the inspiration and motivation you've given all of us, myself at the top of that list. It's always just incredible to hear you play, and I know everybody I know feels the same way, so thanks for all of that.
Well, I mean, it's nice of you to say I'm just trying to keep up with you guys. You know that.
I think we can check that off the to-do list for you. Listen, thanks everybody for joining us today, and we will see you all next time on Bone to Pick.